Good evening and welcome to Linking and Editing Spatial and Tabular Data. Tonight's lecture will be a video lecture because of the snow. I've also posted several videos that you need to watch that cover various aspects of how we can combine data in GIS, as well as a nice introduction on some of the geoprocessing that was in a previous version of ArcGIS Pro, so you can expect to have more capability and perhaps even better design than what you see in the video. And then of course there'll be some video hints there about projections and transformations and that sort of stuff. And the reason those are important is because the next set of exercises is of course on that, and that's your reading is chapter 6 in the cookbook, which revolves around working with those. And your quiz next week will be on the assigned reading from this week, chapter 6, this lecture I'm giving tonight, and all the videos that are posted in this week's Blackboard. So make sure you watch everything, do all your exercises, take your quizzes, get caught up, stay caught up, do well. So we're going to do a bit of a what I call a far-reaching overview. Or we're going to look at chapters 3 and 4 from the cookbook in the biggest possible sense, pulling a lot of information from other sources to kind of just bolster up the wonderful exercises in the cookbook, but the limited amount of theory. So first thing we're going to talk about is joining and relating tables. Now there's a couple of things you got to remember. Joins are temporary relationships. You got two sets, two tables, two data sets, two attribute tables. In order to take the information from one and join it to the other, you have to have a common field. Now once you have that common field where you can align information in table A with information in table B, then it treats the two tables as one. Now the key thing to remember, the original data is unchanged, and with a few clicks of the mouse you can remove joins. Now when we talk about joins, the issue of cardinality comes up, and cardinality has to do in terms of joins with the relationship between the source and the destination. You've got two data sets or two attribute tables that you're trying to join. Cardinality is an indication of whether for every join you make you're joining one item from set A to one item in set B, or are you joining one item from set A to many items in set B, or are you joining many things in A to many things in B, or many things in A to a single thing in B. Each of these are unique in the potential problems that they can create. Some examples of like one-to-one would be capitals to states. One-to-many would be states to cities, okay? In other words, you've got all the cities in the U.S., and you've got a layer of states, and you want to join all of the, you want to join states to the city, so that every city now has a state information attached to it. And so you're taking that one bit of information from like a state, like say California, and you have to add that information to Sacramento, and San Diego, and Oakland, and San Francisco, and Los Angeles, and you get the idea. Many-to-many is a little more complicated. That's a situation where you would identify the groups of information on one data set that would correspond to multiple things on the other, and that's just probably the easiest way to explain it. It literally is just what it sounds like. Many-to-one is slightly different. We talked about joining states to cities. What if we're joining cities to states? And so we have all the population of the cities and we have the states data layer, and I want to know the population of all the cities in each state. Then I have to combine all that city information because I'm only going to join it to one state. And so that is an example of a many-to-one. Now joins and relating tables, some of these are kind of tricky. Many to one, there's just not a really clear way to do that as a single record. your really only options are you have to use something called a relate table or a summarize join. And a relate table is a little different. We'll talk about those in a bit. But summarize joins are, like I said, where you would look at, for example, population. And we're looking at states and cities. And we want all the cities in a state to be summarized on the population field, and that information added to the state. So now we know the population of all the cities in California, which might be an interesting thing to know. For example, if you wanted to compare how the voting patterns across the state related to whether people lived in urban or rural environments by combining the urban populations of the cities to the state, you could then have the total state population and the city-state population, and then of course the difference would be the urban or the rural population. So there's lots of ways you can do that. Sometimes when you try to do these things, you don't get matches. And I'm not talking about like you buy a pack of smokes and nobody gives you a lighter. I'm talking about this thing has to join to that thing, but there's no that thing there. Or this thing is looking for information to be joined to it, and there's nothing there. Typically what you see is in your attribute table you get something called a null response, or it just says null, N-U-L-L. And it doesn't indicate that there is any sort of join. Now, other things that are tricky. You can join multiple items to one table, but you can't join data. That doesn't make a lot of sense. I'm going to elaborate. Say you got three data sets, and you want to join information from one to another. Yeah, you could do that. You could then take that information that you just joined to another and join it to another different data set. So you can join from one to multiple different things. Okay? But you can't join data to a table and then join more data to that same table. The slide may not really be as clear as it should be. You can join multiple items. I should probably be a more accurate way of saying it would be from one table. But you can't join onto joined data. So I mentioned a relate table earlier, and what is a relate table? It's very similar, but it's not the same thing as a join. It's really an exercise in linking across data sets and allows you to deal with those pesky one-to-many, many-to-one, many-to-many kind of relationships. And all it really does is it establishes all those complex links, but it doesn't join the data tabularly. But what it does do is create this linkage between the two data sets so that when you select something in one data set, all the corresponding relationships, all the data in the other data set that is related to it, that is linked to it, that couldn't necessarily be joined because it would have to be some complicated summarized thing, and you didn't want to actually do that. You want to keep the individual records freestanding. That's what this allows you to do. Now, how can we use that to our advantage? It doesn't make for a real handy thing for a lot of complicated automated analysis or generating new data sets. But it does allow you to identify things in one set and select stuff in another, which could, in theory, then allow you to, once you have those things selected, export or otherwise generate a new data set from that. And so you can use the relate to enforce these complex joined-like relationships as a means of selecting information that you want to do something with. All this also comes back a little bit to these field types. I thought I would pull this out from the Mary Beth Price text and stick it in here for you guys just as a sort of quick reminder when we're talking about short, long, float, double text, date, blob. These are all different types of data that could be in a field. And so when you're trying to join or match from one thing to another, if it says 255 and you're thinking, well, this is long, but it's actually text, you might have some issues trying to join those sort of things sometimes. So you got to be careful about that. And you need to understand the limitations of the different types of fields. So sort of the next step in the process after you've joined data usually is because you want to combine multiple types of information, and that usually leads to some sort of a selection process or something of the like. And so I wanted to put a little bit of an overview in here on and some thoughts on selection. And basically we're going to talk about select by attributes. And what select by attributes allows you to do is to pull a subset of data based on those values and records that are stored on the attribute table. And when you have joined data together, you can literally select data from one data set based on information that you attached from another. So that's a really awesome thing. Now, you may have to actually make it permanent in order to make some of these things work. But that's a minor step to solving a big problem. The other cool thing about a lot of these selection things like select by attribute is it allows you to add to and select from selections to build complex selection criteria. And so that's really useful. The one thing you got to remember though, you have to clear those selected features when you're done. Almost every tool in every form of GIS or ArcGIS software that's out there has this built-in ability to allow you to select a subset of data and then perform an analysis just on what's selected. That's a really good thing, but it's only a really good thing when you clearly have selected something that you want to only perform the analysis on. The problem lies in when you're going along some long complicated process you're planning and you do a selection to develop something, maybe it's one of the components in your criteria, and you move on to the next one that will not necessarily reflect those same sort of changes, maybe it will anyway, and you begin to do some sort of counts or calculations or what have you, and the fact that you previously had selected a subset limits the application of what you're now doing, and so that can create a lot of errors. And the biggest concern is not so much that it makes the error, it's that if what happens if it makes the error and you don't realize it made the error, then not only is your outcomes invalidated, in the worst case scenario, they're wrong and you don't know it. So don't forget to do that when it's called for, and also don't forget that you can use selecting subsets before you run tools as a way to do complicated stuff. And so if you do it wrong, that failure will apply to future actions only, because it will only apply to the subsets it's selected. And if you clear the selections when you needed to keep them, it'll do everything to everything, which is not what you want either. So you gotta just be cautious. This is the bottom line. Next, I wanted to just do a quick review on queries. Basically, queries are a means of selection. They extract specific records, and then it is a criteria-based approach. Apologize for all the yawning. Where you look at how you can define these criteria, and they can be basically spatial or aspatial. And so if they're aspatial, the best example is one from the price text. They looked at parcels with a value greater than $100,000. So that's not a spatial parameter. That is a aspatial or a more typical attribute related record or field relative to individual parcels in terms of what's the value. And you said, okay, in this field, we only want results that are higher than this number. Makes sense. Spatial queries are different. Spatial queries were more like parcels that lie completely within a floodplain. The idea being that you have another data set that defines the spatial location, the floodplain, and you're asking how many of these parcels occupy the same geographic space. And that's the difference between spatial and aspatial queries. Queries and select by attributes are all really just different means of accessing subsets of your data. And a lot of times this is based off of a structured query language, SQL. It can be saved, these little bits of coding or language that you use to give it these instructions. It can also be reused and they can be combined. Heck, you can even type it in if you want, but more often than not we access these sort of things via a graphic user interface that we select terms and functions or actions, and it then pieces together the SQL statement that then powers the query or selection process. Select by location, there's lots of different ways you can do this, but I wanted to talk about some of the broader, more geoprocessing-like functions that are very similar. Where with select by location, the way we were classically thinking about it, it's, you know, take this field and I want to find all the stuff that's in the other, you know, area. But there are other sort of tools that do similar things that you need to be aware of. One of those is clip, one is erase, one is intersect, and one is within a distance. And so the clip tool is basically a giant cookie cutter where you just extract a subset of the data as defined by a boundary or another data set. Erase is sort of the inverse of the clip, where the clip cuts out the GUI part that becomes the cookie. The erase cuts the cookie out and throws it away and leaves the gaping hole in amongst the spread out cookie dough. And so that's how I always think about it. An intersect is another common spatial relationship, and it's where things that cross over one another. And then there's other location driven things like within a distance, which is a measure of proximity, which is another means that we can use to select certain things. Spatial joins are not like other joins. You don't have to have those common fields like FIPS numbers or state names or anything. Spatial joins are exclusively the domain of location or proximity. They define what information gets joined to what. And it's not always neat and it's not always clean, but it is always useful. And so let's talk about this a bit. If you got two data sets, it combines them to become one, and it's based on the physical locations they occupy. It doesn't mean they have to occupy the same location, but where they are spatially positioned dictates what gets joined with what. And it does make this new data set. It does not change the original, but it makes a new one. So it's not necessarily really like a temporary thing either. There's sort of basically two types of spatial joins we're going to talk about. Distance spatial joins, which are based on the proximity to a source. And so like I mentioned earlier, proximity would be like distance from. Okay, so when we make a spatial join, what we're doing is asking a simple question like, how far am I from X? And you set a distance threshold, and anything that is within that proximity or that distance becomes selected. So it chooses items in one set that it joins to the closest items in the other, and that's all it really does. This is very similar in some respects to some of the other overlay functions, but it's not exactly the same. Overlay functions combine data similarly, but they also remain to keep the individual components of the data, and it just gives you all those possible combinations, and so it's not exactly the same thing. Oftentimes, when we're thinking about how we're going to do things, it's very easy to confuse spatial joins with other overlay functions. Now, as you get more practice, you can pretty much figure out in a much more timely fashion which one it's going to be. But the big thing is not knowing right away, it's knowing when you start to apply a tool if it's going to work. It's not because you might be able to apply the tool and get an output, but the output may not be what you need, what you want. It may not even work. And so you have to be able to understand how the tools work and what they do so that you can make sure that the tool that you selected and the output that you get is actually what you wanted. Summarized joins are really common when you do distance spatial joins, or any of these joins really, because a lot of times you're dealing with situations where your cardinalities are not necessarily one-to-one. Think cities that are closest to particular airports, and so it might be, you know, it could be as simple as what city is closest. That would be the airport to the city. But if it's cities to airports, each airport has, every city has to be close to, has to be closest to one airport. But an individual airport might have multiple cities, and so you won't have a one-to-one cardinality. So it can get complicated. Inside joins, one feature is inside of another is the best way to think about it, and this is much more like a, as we would perceive, an overlay function, and so it's even easier to confuse. Again, summarized joins are also common because you deal a lot of times with issues where your cardinalities are no longer going to be one-to-one. So that's kind of your big generic overview. So let's take a moment here and we'll just take a quick look at Chapter 3, linking data together, and see what exactly this chapter is going to cover. What's in store for you? You've got about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You got about 7 activities in this chapter. Starts off pretty simple, where you'll be joining tables together, and then you'll be labeling features using a joined table, querying data in a joined table, creating and using a relate, which is something that honestly I've never really used outside of academic exercises. They're really interesting and they have a lot of potential, but they're somewhat obscure in that they're only applicable every now and then, and it's easy to overlook the utility that exists in a relate function. So that fourth one should be one that you can potentially really learn a valuable lesson from. And of course, then joining features spatially as opposed to based on attributes. And creating feature-linked annotation and creating and using relationship classes from existing data. All these are different exercises that you will go through that are essential ways that you can learn to be better at your GIS work. Chapter 4 is about editing spatial and tabular data, and I didn't really talk too much about that. Editing tends to be more of an issue of the buttonology or the mechanics of the software than anything else. I mean, editing really just boils down to taking something and changing it, fixing it, correcting it, making it, moving it, shifting it. That kind of stuff. It's not like there's just a wonderful theory on how to move a point or how to make a line that we need to discuss in much detail. It's really just the process of going through with the software, repeating the steps, learning the exercises, so that when the time comes that you have to do these sort of things, you can do them with little or no hesitation. So what's in store? Even more stuff in Chapter 4. It starts off, you know, showing you how to configure your editing options, because there are lots of little things that you can do, like setting tolerances and thresholds and snapping and these sorts of things, which all contribute mightily to how close you have to be when you start clicking to make changes happen when you're physically manipulating the shapes of things, or selecting the types of fields that you're going to use so that you can put in a text entry into an attribute table, or do you need a numeric one, and if so, how large, and what does that mean in terms of the data type? Should it be floating point? And those kind of things are important, and so there's opportunities to learn about that. Reshaping an existing feature is basically just editing and showing how there's different ways that you can go in and do things like cut polygons in half or change nodes and that sort of stuff, splitting up lines, merging features together, lining things up, creating new points and new lines and new polygons, and then using the autocomplete tool so that you don't have to draw everything all the time, but you can just build off of and add on to things. That's really useful. It's a shame that more more local GIS offices didn't start using things like this and enforcing topology when they started developing a lot of their GIS layers, because now these things become more automated and they exist a lot more frequently. But we're oftentimes left dealing with legacy data, and legacy data often has legacy problems, and a legacy problem might be a lack of understanding of the importance of doing that, or at times even the technical difficulty of building those things that have topological integrity. And then the last two are editing issues, editing attributes in the attribute pane, and editing attributes in table view are just different ways that you can go in and make those changes. So if I had to sum it all up from these exercises you're going to do over the next week, 2 weeks if you need it, you're going to be combining, subsetting, joining, relating, editing, making, modifying data, and frankly so much more. This is the middle part of a GIS experience. So when I think about learning GIS, the first thing is just learning the general function, operation, layout, and design of the software. The second is about conditioning, reconditioning, and combining data sets. And the third is about instituting some form of analysis on the newly formed data. And then the last would be visualizing or geovisualizing or otherwise representing the knowledge that you gained by converting that data into usable, tangible, understandable things. So, quick reminder, quiz next week, and it's on the assigned reading, chapter 6, the YouTube videos that I posted this week, and not necessarily this lecture, although there'll be enough overlap in the other videos that it's going to be a lot of the same stuff too, or at least parts of the same stuff. But I will pull the questions off of the YouTube videos for sure, for a significant portion of that quiz, and the rest coming from chapter 6 in terms of what it asks you to do. So read through those exercises, and those are the things you need to be watching out for in the videos especially, because that'll be a significant part of the quiz too. So that'll give you some idea what we're expecting. This video here is about a half an hour long. You've got four or five other videos that account for probably close to an hour and 20 minutes to an hour and a half. So all I'm told, you're looking at about 2 hours worth of watching and listening, but you don't have to do it all at once. It might be a good thing to do to break up the monotony of going through those exercises, but at the end of the day, you need to do them both. You got to do the exercises, and you need to obviously watch these videos, because that's what you're going to be quizzed on next week. So otherwise, enjoy your snow evening, and remember, snow is just a state of mind, and I believe the milk and bread industry is behind it. I think they bribed the National Weather Service to bring in snow when their supplies become overabundant and they have a surplus of milk and bread. That's just the conspiracy theorist in me speaking. There's no scientific, factual, or even gullible evidence to support that claim, but it would be a really nice conspiracy to have going on there, given that it seems like everyone goes and buys milk and bread every time we get, you know, calls for a snowstorm. Go figure. All right. Have a good weekend, and we'll see you in class next week.